Okay, I removed the original battery. You can see the corrosion that was beginning to form on the circuit board, especially around the positive side. So I'll take some alcohol and try to clean that off as best I can. Then I'll put on the replacement battery. I got the metal frame bent back into shape, and I also replaced the battery. This is actually a nickel metal hydride battery, whereas the original was NiCad, but it should work just fine. And I did a terrible job of soldering it as usual, but I did check the continuity to the traces on the motherboard, and it is showing the correct voltage there, so it should be fine. It's actually reading about 3.8 volts, even though it's only rated at 3.6, so it did come pre-charged. It was all going so well with this Amiga. I got the clock battery replaced. I was able to straighten out the case. I even replaced the pads on the bottom because all the original rubber feet were missing. I even got some screws at the hardware store to replace the ones that were missing because the case uses screws that are not a common size with PCs, so I didn't have any in my collection. But then I decided to take apart the two halves of the video toaster card. And I saw this. At first I thought this chip here had blown, but then I looked on the other card that was facing it, because originally this was like that on top of it. And I saw right there a blown capacitor. And unfortunately there's no markings on the board for the capacitors. There's no like C1, C2, C3, they're all non-marked. So I might try to get in touch with NewTek, the company which made this, which is still in business. And I guess I'll have to send them a photo of this so they can identify which one it is, and maybe they can look up on their parts list and tell me the value so I can replace that, because whatever's left of that capacitor doesn't have any markings on it. So I wouldn't know what value to replace it with. So unfortunately the video toaster will probably be on hold until the next installment of this video series. But I do have a few more parts coming in the mail for this. A fellow YouTuber offered to send me a keyboard for it, which is very nice. I'm very thankful for that. And I also got a floppy drive for it on eBay. So I'll have most of the parts to get this thing fully up and running, just except for the video toaster. I also discovered that this actually has 7 megabytes of RAM, not 9 as I thought. There's 1 megabyte on the motherboard, 4 megabytes on the CPU accelerator card, and another 2 on the hard drive controller. And speaking of the hard drive, it's a 100 megabyte hard drive, and I saw on the workbench screen is 97 megabytes of it are occupied. There's only about 2.5 megabytes of free space on it. But it just so happens that I have this 1 gigabyte external SCSI hard drive, which I could hook up to the connector on the back here, assuming that this even supports a hard drive this big. I'll try it and see if it works, and maybe I'll copy whatever's on this hard drive into the one that's on here, and then swap this one on the board here. It is now day 3 of making this video, and today this floppy drive arrived for the Amiga. It is a Chinen FB357, and the only thing you need to do to one of these to make it work in an Amiga 2000 or 2500 is this jumper on the back. I had to change it from DS0 to DS1. It's a drive select jumper, and after that I was able to plug it in. It works just fine, and it's also the taller size, so it'll look correct and fit the opening in the front of the case. And this is actually a high density drive. That's the 357. The original low or double density drive was the FB354, which is what the Amiga 2000 originally came with, but found this cheaper on eBay than one of those. And it works, it just won't work as a high density drive, although on the Amiga the standard double density format is actually 880 kilobytes instead of only 720 for a PC or 800 for a Mac. So you do get a little bit more space on each disk than you do for PC or Mac when you use the Amiga format. And there is the floppy drive installed in the case, which isn't as easy to do as it sounds because the screws that hold the drive cage into place don't go into holes, they go into slots. So you get a lot of adjustment of how to position it. So it takes a couple tries to get it right to line up with the case on the front here. Another thing about these Amiga floppy drives is that the pin one stripe on the cable goes on the outside, whereas on most PC floppy drives it goes on the inside. And you also notice that the twist in the cable for the drive A is in a different position than on a PC cable, and it's also a different amount of conductors that are twisted. You can see here is a PC floppy drive cable. This is pin 1 on this edge, and you can see the twist is more towards the center and more of the wires are twisted. So if you come across an Amiga that's missing the floppy drive cable, unfortunately you won't be able to use a regular PC floppy drive cable, at least not without custom modifying it to change the wires that are twisted. Syntax Video asked how the hard card is held into place, and the answer is not very well. Just has this normal PC expansion card bracket on the back here and this plastic guide on the front, which is definitely not ideal because you can see the actual card connection is up front here while the bracket that's holding it in place is towards the back. So all it takes a little bit of twist to this frame and it'll pop right out of its socket, which is what happened when I got this. So if you're going to ship one of these Amigas with a hard card, I would definitely recommend taking it out and packaging it separately. There is the huge glob of glue holding the broken off front panel post in place. And I also glued this LED bezel in place against the front of the case there. I got all the cards reinstalled except for the video toaster, which is still awaiting repair or replacement. Got the front of the case reassembled. Removed that sticker which said MIMH on it. I looked it up. That stands for Missouri Institute of Mental Health. And the eBay seller I got this from was in Missouri. So that's where this computer originally came from. The verdict of the floppy drive is that it mostly works. It can read and write disks in both PC 720K and Amiga formats, but it only recognizes the disk if I have it in the drive when I first turn on the machine. And it also doesn't recognize when I change the disk. So even if I take this disk out and put another one in, the icon on the desktop will not change. And it also doesn't seem to be able to format disks. It just says the track 0 is bad every time, even on a good disk. This is a PC 720K formatted disk, and it's smart enough to skip over it if it's not a bootable disk. So it's booting up from the hard drive. See, here's the disk I formatted on my PC. It says DOS on the icon. So if I open it up, you see one file I created. Oh, there it goes. Oh. I don't know if I have a text editor on this thing. Oh, where would that be? Tools. Emacs. Oh, that's one of those, See, on Amiga, you use the right mouse button for the menus, so you have to kind of get used to that. Visit file? I was just going to ask, I don't have a keyboard yet, so it's going to ask me the file name. Well, I don't think I'll be able to actually open up this file until I get a keyboard for that text editor, but I can at least copy it to the Amiga's hard drive here. Let's see. Copy. Okay. It also supports Macintosh 800K floppy disks, although I have not tried that. So, floppy drive does have some issues, but I guess it's good enough for now. Since I have all the software I need on the hard drive. Now, as you can see, the hard drive is 97% full. There's only about 2.6 megabytes free out of the 100 megabyte drive. So, definitely cutting it rather close to the limit there. But that is with all the video toaster software and everything installed. And until I get the video toaster working, this is about as much as I can do for now, so I'll just shut it down here. Over on the PC, you can see the copy of that file that I made on the Amiga, although the PC doesn't recognize the long file names that the Amiga uses. And it says 1989 because I discovered you can't change the year on the Amiga without using a keyboard. Although I was able to change the month, day, and time, so all of that is correct. Just the year is still 1989 and will be until I get a keyboard, but it is keeping the time and date, so the battery is good.